sturdy rock. Out of his great love, I've learned the meaning of salvation. Out of his great love.
Your love was never far. You made a way to get to me. You were the whisper leading me to your heart. Forever I belong to you. Now I can see clearly. Holding on to you.
All right, good morning, Peace Saving. I hope you're doing well today. And we just want to take a few moments here just to tell you that we are just thrilled to celebrate Memorial Day weekend. It's just a fantastic thing to know that there were people in our country, men and women in our country, willing to give their lives that we might have the freedom that we have today. If you rejoice in the freedom that you have today, say amen. I tell you, and here's the thing, you know, a lot of people, as we celebrate this weekend, gave their lives, but every person that has been in service was willing to give their life. And so if you served in our armed forces in any branch, men and women today, if you would please just stand to your feet right now, if you would stand up just where you are just for a moment. And would you give these men and women a hand today? Thank you so much for your service and your willingness to pay the ultimate price if you were called upon to do so. But of course, you know, I know many of you, as we will acknowledge in just a few moments, many of you know people or have people in your family that did give the ultimate price. And we're going to acknowledge that in just a few moments in a very significant and sentimental way. Before we do that, though, I do want to make mention that they had to take Mimi to the hospital last night. Joe was just telling me that she's got a blood clot in her leg. So we want to be praying for Mimi today. Thank you so much for being here today. And as I was looking around, I don't see Melissa Blanton, but I think she fell and broke her arm. And so I don't think she's able to be with us today. So y'all pray for David and Melissa. They're new members of our church. And let's be in prayer, of course, for them. As we go to our prayer focus today, first of all, I want to acknowledge our shut-in of the week. That is Mary Wilmoth, and we love Mary. Mary, I hope you're able to watch. I talked to her not long ago, and I'm just waiting for her to walk in the door any week now. By the way, I've been waiting for Reba Hollingsworth to walk in the door, and she is here today. I don't know where she's sitting, but I know she's not in her normal seat. Were you, Reba? Oh, you backslid. You used to sit three rows up. Look, you stay out for a while, and you backslide all the way to the back row. So, but there's Reba back there, and we're so thrilled that she's here with us today. She hadn't been able to be with us. Reba, we love you, and so glad that you're able to be here. And Mary, we're looking forward to you being able to be with us as well, so we're going to be in prayer for you. For our Deacon of the Month, of course, Mr. Perry and Ms. Elisa over here, and we're so grateful for them. Fantastic job that they do serving us. And then our missionary, of course, of the month is Andy and Lily Smith over in China, and we continue to pray for them. So let's do this. Let's stand together and let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll have Miss Rebecca to come. Father, thank you so much today for sacrifice. God, our Bible tells us, greater love has no man than this, that he'd lay down his life for his friends. Lord, we celebrate today, this weekend, Lord, specifically tomorrow, Lord, just a day when we'd come together and Lord, we're just grateful for men and women who were willing to give their lives that we might have this freedom that we have today. And Lord, we'd be derelict to our duty in a church setting or in any setting not to acknowledge that you paid the ultimate price and you set the ultimate example 2,000 years ago. You laid down your life for us that we might have freedom and we might be liberated from sin itself and the slavery of that. So Lord, we thank you so much for setting that example. We thank you for those in our armed forces that have followed that example. And Lord, we pray for those today that, Lord, have had loved ones and friends that have paid that price. So God, comfort their hearts today as we go into this commemoration. God, I pray, Lord, today you'd be with our missionaries in China, be with the Smiths. God, thank you for them. God, I pray, Lord, that today that you would, of course, be with Perry and Elisa as they lead in our church. God, give them wisdom. Lord, be with Mary today. Thank you for her, Lord. I hope she's able to watch today. And Lord, I hope that she feels our love. I hope she's able to be with us soon. Lord, we ask these things, of course, in the name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen and amen.
You may be seated. Tomorrow we celebrate Memorial Day, America does, and this morning we wanted to take a few moments to remember the lost lives of the men and women of our nation's military personnel who have given the ultimate sacrifice, like Pastor John said, in service to our country. So this morning, as Lacey sings, I would like to invite y'all to participate in this moment. So if you have someone in your family or even a close friend that you've lost during their service to in the military and fighting for our country, would you come forward, and or you can send a representative from your family down to the front. We have flags placed here on either pedestal, so in memory of them, if you would like to come during her song and place a flag in our arrangement down here, we would love for you to participate in memory of those that have died in service to our country.
are stored. He hath loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us live to make men free. While God is marching on,
let's stand together, church.
Fitting each year that we remember those who have paid the ultimate price to secure our freedom. But you know, this morning it's important that we, as Pastor John said, remember that we need to celebrate each and every day the one who paid the greatest price to secure our freedom from the bondage of sin, but also to secure our freedom to eternal life. And today we know him, and his name is Jesus Christ. And we have the opportunity, of course, to be able to look back to the text, to be able to look back to the scriptures, to see examples of the way that God has interacted with us throughout history in order to bring about this redemption, this salvation. And what we see from stories like Ruth and stories like Naomi is that we see a God who is faithful. We see a God who is faithful to rescue, a God who's faithful to redeem, a God who is faithful to provide, a God who's faithful to protect. And what we know is that Jesus has told us that in this world we will have trouble. We know that. We're going to have trouble. But isn't it wonderful today that we have a place of refuge, a place that we can run to hide? And today we're going to look at Psalm chapter 91. And I think it's fitting because we see an example in Naomi and Ruth as they returned to Bethlehem. They returned to the presence of God. And as they returned to his presence, they found that refuge, didn't they? They found refuge under his wings. And so today we're going to look at what it is to find refuge in the Lord and what those who find refuge in him and his presence have. So let's read Psalm 91 together. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him I will trust. Surely he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, nor of the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor of the destruction that lays waste at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Only with your eyes shall you look and see the reward of the wicked. Because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place. No evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent you shall trample underfoot. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore I will deliver him. I will set him on high, because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him, and I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. You know, today we realize and we know that salvation came at a great price, the price of the blood of the precious Lamb of God, Jesus Christ. And so this morning we're going to worship and praise him and exalt him and glorify him and lift up his name today as he is our all in all. So let's lift our voices and sing together, church.
There was mercy in your eyes. to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. You saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake, you died. Dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Thank you. so kind to me. Deserve it, but still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God.
Thank you.
know, there's so many adjectives that we could put before God's love today, but the one that stands out to me is this: it's unconditional. And we have to think about that, and we have to do our best to fathom the unfathomable on that. It is unconditional. What that means is this: that means that there's nothing that you can do that can take God's love away from you. Nothing can separate you from the love of God today. If you're a believer today, God's love for you stands. And by the way, if you're an unbeliever today, our Bible says God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. And so today, God loves you. That's the greatest news I can give you today. He loves you, and that love is unconditional. Nothing's going to change that love. You can reject it, and many have. And I hope that you won't be one of those that do. Today, if you're an unbeliever, if you don't know Jesus as your Savior, today would be the day. You know, when I was a kid, growing up, I was a jock, and I played just about every sport there was to play, you know, that was conventional in high school. But I tell you, any time that I would turn the television on, whether it be on Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, any time that I would turn the television on and golf was on, I would immediately turn the channel. And the reason I would do that is because I thought golf was the most boring thing in the world to watch. And I could not fathom for a moment actually stepping on a golf course, stepping on a tee box, and driving a golf ball, because I just thought that's the silliest thing in the world. And it didn't really look that difficult to me at all. It just seemed like that it was just a waste of time and just a waste of sports activity. However, when I got to college, I got a set of golf clubs. I went out to the golf course, and I realized, not as easy as it looks. And also realized, kind of fun. And then I found myself doing something. The more I played golf, I never have gotten any good at it, but the more I have played it, the more I have become immersed into that culture. And here's what I found myself doing. When I turn the television on now, it's much different than when I was a teenager. Now when I turn it on, I have a great appreciation for Phil Mickelson at 50 years old winning the PGA last week. Wasn't that something? I mean, I love Phil Mickelson for this reason. He was born the same year that I was born, and he's left-handed. And so I'm going to go for the guy just for that reason, but also just for the history last week. As I was watching Phil, and I was watching that great historic win and all those records broken, you know, I thought to myself, you know, 40 years ago, you could not have paid me to watch this. And now I can't move from the television because I understand the difficulty of the shot. I understand the joy of making the shot. I understand every aspect of the game other than having a good score. I don't understand that. I hadn't got there yet. But I understand all that. Now, the reason I'm saying that is this. Many of you from time to time, or many of you maybe every week, you walk into Peace Saving Baptist Church or a church of the like, and you find it boring. You're bored with church. You're bored with God, and here's why. You don't speak the language yet. The reason you're bored is not because it's boring any more than I was bored with golf. I was bored with golf. Watching golf was simply because of this. I had not experienced golf. I had not been on the course. I could not appreciate a good shot. I could not, you know, understand, you know, the difficulty of playing on the links. And ladies and gentlemen, the truth is, you know, in Christianity, some of this is the same, because many of you, as you walk into church, many of you may be listening live stream, it may be that you are bored with church, disenchanted with God, and you wonder, what's going on with all these other people? Why do these other people like watching golf? Why do these other people enjoy playing golf? Why is it? It's because they've immersed themselves into that culture and they have a great appreciation for it, so they can sit by the TV and enjoy the shot, enjoy a great shot, understand the enthusiasm of the players and the gallery, because you're part of it. And it's sad but true, many people have grown up in church, but they're bored with church, bored with the Bible, bored with God, because they are not part of the culture. They're on the outside looking in and wondering, what's so great about this? I'll tell you what's great about it. When you actually immerse yourself into the Christian culture and you allow the Word of God to feed your soul and you understand the true sacrifice of Jesus Christ, when you walk into church, if you have fed your soul that week with the Word of God, you come in hungry and you are standing by the TV, eyes wide open, wondering when the next shot is coming and how good it's going to be. So today, your boredom has nothing to do with God being boring, because He's not. Your boredom has nothing to do with the Word of God being boring, because it's not. Your boredom has nothing to do with the gospel being boring, because the gospel is the greatest news ever. It's life-changing. It's life-altering. It's the difference between a person's eternal soul, whether it goes to heaven or it goes to hell. Ladies and gentlemen, God, the church, the Bible, the gospel, best things in the world. Jesus Christ, the best thing going. The reason you're bored is because you're not part of the culture. You don't speak the language. I took Spanish in high school. ¿Cómo está? Say bien or something. Come on, y'all. The problem is, that's all I know, and that's pretty much all you know. Gracias, de nada. That's about as far as it goes. See, I've sat in a classroom, but I have not been immersed into Hispanic culture. And so I don't have a great appreciation for the language. I don't speak the language fluently, because the most I've ever done is sat in a class and learned a little bit of the language to the point that I can say hello. Now, when the Spanish people start talking, or Hispanic people start talking back, I don't have a clue. How many of y'all know what you're talking about? ¿Cómo está? They say something back, and I just go, I don't have a clue what they're saying, you know? I know, ¿cómo está? Gracias, muy bien, or bien, and de nada, and that's about it. That's about it. Hola, I know hola. I know agua. You say, well, Pastor John, you're just fluent. No, I'm not. Words just kind of come to me, but I have no clue. Because I don't speak the language, because I haven't been immersed in the language. Some people think, oh yeah, I'm going to take a Spanish class and I'm going to know the language. You don't know the language till you get it. See, in order to be fluent in the language, you not only have to speak it, you got to understand it when it's spoken back. For me, the problem's not speaking it. For me, the problem is knowing what in the world they just said back to me. And that's true in any language. And so today, I just say this to you, as you open up your Bible today, open it up with enthusiasm and ask God, if you've been bored with church, you've been bored with God, if you've been bored with the gospel, if it means absolutely nothing to you, it's because you are not immersed in the culture, you're not part of it. You're on the outside looking in, and you're wondering what in the world is going on. And you don't know. You don't know. And that might be the most important thing that I can say to you today, is there are people that are in these congregations just like this. They don't speak the language. If you don't speak the language today, realize this. You can begin today. God wants to open your eyes and open your heart to exactly what is going on today. And we're in Ruth chapter 2, and we're under His wings. Under His wings. We've been following the story of Ruth, and we have discovered the danger of becoming an unbelieving believer. An unbelieving believer. Unbelieving believers have no problem trusting God for salvation, but they struggle in trusting God for security and direction. Many of you today, you would be considered an unbelieving believer. What that means is simply this. It means I have no problem trusting God for my salvation, but I have a real problem in trusting Him with everything else. And ladies and gentlemen, today, can I just remind you that if you've trusted Him with your salvation, you are trusting Him with the greatest need that you have. The most awesome miracle that He can work is your salvation. If He can work that out, ladies and gentlemen, He can work everything else out in your life as well. But unbelieving believers, they have no problem trusting God for salvation, but they struggle in trusting God for security. They struggle in trusting God for direction. And ladies and gentlemen, God wants us to trust Him in all of our ways, as Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 says. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not into your own understanding. In all your ways, if you'll acknowledge Him, the Bible says He will direct your path. He promises to direct our path. It's a trust that extends well beyond our own understanding. Now, the reason I'm starting off with that is because you remember at the beginning of this book, it was Elimelech, the father, who trusted in his own understanding instead of trusting beyond his understanding. The Bible says, trust the Lord with all your heart, lean not into your own understanding. Your own understanding. Elimelech says, you know, what I understand is I'm in a famine, I'm hungry, and I need to get out of Bethlehem. Well, if he'd have trusted God beyond his understanding, he would have understood, yes, I'm in a famine, but the famine we've brought on ourselves, God is able to deliver us to the famine, so I'm going to stay in Bethlehem instead of leaving and going to Moab. As soon as Elimelech removed himself from Bethlehem, you remember Bethlehem is the house of bread. It represents God's place of protection. It represents God's place of provision. So Elimelech, actually, when he stepped out, you remember Pastor Jared a couple of weeks ago, I like how he put this because he said, you know, once you step out of God's will, now at that point, you have positioned yourself to pay the tab yourself. You're paying your own tab at that point. If you are in the middle of the will of God, if you're in your Bethlehem, here's what's happening in that. What's happening is that is God has promised to provide for you and to protect you. But once you step out of Bethlehem and you head to Moab, even though Moab looks better and it looks more promising, you remember what happened with Elimelech. He steps out of Bethlehem to avoid death, and when he gets to Moab, he encounters death. He dies, Mahlon dies, Chilion dies, his two sons, and leaves Naomi with two daughters-in-law, Ruth and Orpah, as we've looked through that story. But as the story continues, you remember Elimelech's widow, Naomi, after 10 years of being down in Moab outside of God's will, she hears that God is blessing Bethlehem once again. And so she returns to Bethlehem 10 years after their departure, but our Bible tells us this, the Lord brought her back empty. Remember what she said? She said, I left full. I left full. I was in God's will in Bethlehem 10 years ago. I left full, and now the Lord has brought me back empty. I left a mother. I'm coming back without children. I left a wife. I'm coming back without a husband. I left wealthy. I'm coming back with no resources whatsoever. And so we see in her life that it has taken a turn for the worse because of the decision that Elimelech has made. But here's the thing, when she comes back, you say, Pastor John, she's got nothing. She's got no resources, she's got no husband, she's got no children. Can I remind you of something in her life and something in your life too? Regardless of what's going on, she still has God. She still has God. And as we talked about last week, God is always enough. You know, we saw last week, and let me give you a quick review here. God has a particular period. God has a particular place, God has a particular person, and God has a particular principle that's involved in His provision and protection for you. You remember the particular period, as they come back, when did they come back? During the barley harvest. That's a period of time that God has ordained. Number two, there's a particular place, it's Bethlehem. God has ordained that as His place of protection and His place of provision. Then there's a particular person. His name is Boaz. We met him a few weeks ago. And then, of course, there's a particular principle, and that's the biblical principle of gleaning. In all of that, particular period, particular place, particular person, particular principle. And because all of those things are being honored, God can get to work. And that's exactly what He is going to do. If you've been following the story, there are three main characters in the book of Ruth. I should say three main human characters. God is the main character of the entire Bible. But each character has very distinct roles. Each character has very distinct traits that are integral to the plot. Today I'm going to do something that I typically do not do. As a matter of fact, this is totally different than my usual. Instead of looking at these verses consecutively, as I typically do, I'm going to examine them only as they describe each one of these personalities. And so I'll be skipping through, still covering these verses, but skipping through just to feature the particular traits and characteristics of each person. And person number one that we're going to look at, we've already mentioned his name, is Boaz. And we're going to call him the Redeemer. Because in this passage, in this book, he is the kinsman redeemer. He's the figure of Jesus Christ in the Old Testament. And so let's do this. Let's read verse 10, because this is the transitional verse from what we looked at last week to what we're going to look at this week. Last week we saw how that Boaz saw Ruth out in the field. He said, whose damsel is this? And they said, well, this is Ruth. She's the Moabitess that came back with Naomi, and she has come to glean. And do you remember what Boaz said to her? Boaz apparently has been smitten with this beautiful girl. And so he comes up to her, and he says to her, hey, listen, don't glean in any other field. Drink at the executive water cooler, you know, whatever you need. Here I am. And then Ruth responds in verse 10 with this. The Bible says that Ruth, in verse 10, she fell on her face. She bowed down to the ground, and she said to Boaz, here it is, why have I found favor in your eyes that you should take notice of me, since I am a foreigner? Ruth responds to the kindness of Boaz with a simple question. Why have you chosen to show kindness to me? I'm just a Moabitess. I am a foreigner. Now, can we just start off with this? That's the same question I've been asking Jesus all my life. Why in the world have you chosen me? Why have you loved me? Why did you die for me? Why have I found favor? Because I know myself and I'm not worthy of it. I'm undeserving of it. And why in the world would God love me unconditionally? Why would God send his son to die for me? Why in the world would God put Jesus through that humiliation? And let's just be honest. Why would God put himself through that humiliation? Because Jesus and God are one and the same. Why is Philippians 2 true? Why did he humble himself and become obedient unto death, even the death of the cross? Why would he do that? Why would he do that for me? And that's the question I'm still asking, and that is the question that Ruth is asking right here. Perhaps you found yourself looking to heaven with that similar question. Why has God shown favor to any of us? What did we do to deserve eternal redemption from the slavery of sin? In this story, just be reminded, Boaz, to a degree, represents the person of redemption. And first of all, I want to give you three characteristics of him as we see here in the passage. Number one, watch how he responds. Number one, he responds in pity. Verse 11, our Bible says, and Boaz answered and said to Ruth, it has been fully reported to me. In other words, I know the whole story. How many of y'all know this today? God knows your whole story. You can't hide anything from him. He knows your story. Your parents may not know, but God knows your whole story. So Boaz says to her, it's been fully reported to me all that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband, and how you have left your father and your mother in the land of Moab, your birth, and have come to a people whom you did not know before. What Boaz does is he answers Ruth's question with words of compassion. He had heard of Ruth's return. He knew the story. He knew how she had returned to Bethlehem. You remember how Naomi had said to her and Orpah? She said to them, just go back to your religion, go back to your relations, go back to your family, go back to your gods. And Orpah says, okay, she kissed Naomi, she goes back, we never hear from her again. But here, what we see is we see Ruth, and remember what Ruth said to her. Ruth said to her, where you go, I'm going. Where you live, I'm going to live. Where you die, I'm going to die. And here's most importantly, she said, your God is going to be my God. Apparently, Boaz has heard about this particular response. So he understands that Ruth has chosen not to go back to her people, but has chosen to come and live in Bethlehem with Naomi's people, and most importantly, to serve Naomi's God. He knew that her husband Mahlon had died. He knew that her father-in-law had died. He knew that her brother-in-law Chilion had died. And the tragic deaths of all of those had left Ruth in a seemingly hopeless condition. And by the way, by no fault of her own. So Boaz is a man of compassion. He acknowledges that he has been fully informed as to her condition. He fully understands she cannot help herself. Boaz is a man of compassion, and he shows pity toward Ruth. Notice secondly, though, he's also a man of prayer. You got to love this in verse 12. Our Bible tells us in verse 12, he said, the Lord repay your work, and a full reward be given you by the Lord God of Israel. And here's what we've been reading about today, under whose wings you have come for refuge. What a beautiful prayer. First of all, I know all about your story. Now here's my prayer. And what a beautiful prayer. What a great analogy with it. Boaz petitions heaven to bless Ruth as she abides under the wings of the Almighty, the Lord God, Jehovah Elohim. We earlier saw the spiritual heart of Boaz. You remember chapter 2, verse 4. Let's think about what the setting is. This is the time of the judges. In the time of the judges, it was every man did that which was right in his own eyes. So it's a dark culture. It's a heathenistic culture. It's a pagan culture. And so Boaz, in the midst of all this darkness, spiritual darkness, Boaz says in chapter 2, verse 4, he says, the Lord be with you. And you remember how the people responded as he's creating this counterculture. In the darkness, they respond back, the Lord bless you. And so we already can see into Boaz's heart that in the midst of all of this dark culture, that he is going to be a thermostat, not a thermometer. So here in verse number 12, here we encounter a little more of Boaz's spiritual heart. He earnestly and sincerely asks God's blessing over Ruth. Now it's almost as if, you know, sometimes, you get on a three-way call on your phone, and you're talking to there's three different people on the call. Well, that's kind of how this verse comes across. Because it's like Boaz is talking to Ruth, but he's also talking to God at the same time. Say, I'm telling Ruth, this is what I'm asking God for you. This is my prayer for you. I'm praying that God will bless you. He's praying a blessing over Ruth. And again, think about it. Here's a wealthy landowner. He's a businessman, and he is stooping right here in this story. He is stooping to the side of a poor outsider, a stranger from Moab. But from verse 12, we learn something of great significance. In his prayer, Boaz does not, and this is so important, Boaz, as the wealthy businessman, Boaz, as the affluent landowner, he does not show up. He doesn't rip his shirt off and have a big S on his chest that says Superman. Boaz does something totally different. Boaz says, if you're going to be blessed, I'm not the blesser. He's the blesser. Boaz does not point to himself as the answer. He points Ruth to the Lord as the answer. Hey, can I remind all of us of something today? You're not the answer to anybody's problem. I'm not the answer to anybody's problem, anybody's spiritual problem. I'm not the answer. You're not the answer. He's the answer. So our job, our responsibility today, is not to present ourselves as the answer to somebody's problem. Now, God may use us as a counselor. God may use us as a philanthropist or a benefactor, I guess we would say. God may use us or use some of the resources that we have to bless somebody else. But I remind you of James chapter 1, verse 17. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, which comes down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness nor shadow of turning. What James is reminding us of is this. If there's a good gift for somebody to receive, whether it be salvation or anything beyond that, it does not come from you. It does not come from me. It comes from Him. And you may say, well, hold on, Pastor John. I gave the money. God gave you the money. You say, I gave the counsel. The Holy Spirit gave you the counsel. You're just a conduit, and I'm just a conduit. That's all that I am of God's grace and God's wisdom. And so I'm not the answer to your problem. And nobody in this room is the answer to your problem. Like Boaz, what we need to be doing is we need to be pointing people to Jesus, because He is the answer to the problem. He is the way. Yes, go ahead. He's the way, He's the truth, He's the life, and He is our wisdom. When our Bible says, if you lack wisdom, James says this, if you lack wisdom, ask of God. He'll give it to you. Jesus is our wisdom. We're supposed to have the mind of Christ. And in doing so, the Holy Spirit of God teaches us all things, brings all things to remembrance, so that we can help other people. But at the end of the day, it is not Boaz saying, look to me, I am your provider, I'm your protector. No, God may use Boaz and is going to use Boaz as a provider and a means of protection. But when it's all said and done, it is God using Boaz, it's not Boaz. So Boaz, in his prayer, I love what he does. He points Ruth, not to himself, he points Ruth to God for her blessing and her provision, even though he's apparently a man of means. He turns Ruth to God. He encourages her to trust God. And ladies and gentlemen, as believers, we got to be reminded, we're not the spiritual solution. We're in as much need as anybody that comes to us. Now, of course, Boaz is going to be used to bless Ruth. But Boaz is sent from God, and all that Boaz has was given to him by God. So once again, I reiterate, no human being is the solution to a spiritual problem. Ruth needs help, God sends Boaz, and in the physical sense, Boaz is going to serve as her redeemer. Not in the spiritual sense, but in the physical sense, Boaz is going to give us an Old Testament picture in the physical of what Jesus Christ does for us in the spiritual. It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing. And we'll see that a little more clearly as we move forward through the series. But today, can we all be grateful in the very fact that in our lostness and in our spiritual need, God didn't send us a human being. God sent us Himself in the person of Jesus Christ. And He alone has the power to redeem us, to buy us back from the very enslavery of sin itself. In our salvation, Jesus, and only Jesus, is our Redeemer. So Boaz speaks a beautiful and colorful analogy from a heart of worship, you know, as we see in verse 12, that I personally believe carries great significance in the lineage of Boaz. And here's why. The words he uses are very similar to the words that Pastor Jared read in Psalm 91. Let's read it together again. Let's read this excerpt real quick, and let's go back and let's revisit. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. You remember, Almighty comes from the Hebrew El Shaddai. Abraham, when God told Abraham and reiterated to Abraham that Sarah was going to have the son of promise, Isaac, it's impossible for Sarah at her age to conceive a child. And God says, no, I am the Almighty. I am the El Shaddai. I can do the impossible. And so the psalmist here is saying that it's a great thing to abide under the wings of the Almighty God, the El Shaddai. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge. He is my fortress, my God. In Him I will trust. He goes on to say, I will say of the Lord, surely He shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. A pestilence is a disease. He shall cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and your buckler. And He goes on to say, you shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day. Now, reason I'm taking you there, we're not 100% sure who wrote Psalm 91. Most likely Moses or David. It's going to be attributed probably in most commentaries, most theologians historical theologians are going to go to Moses or David. If Moses wrote it, Boaz in this chapter is merely repeating a writing of Moses from the past. But if David wrote it, that's a whole different story. If David wrote it, Boaz might very well be coining the phrase or the idea about being under the protective wings of God. Now here's the thing about David. Trace David back. Boaz marries Ruth. We'll get to this in a little more detail later. Boaz marries Ruth. They have a little son. His name is Obed. Obed means worship or worshiper. Obed has a son. His name is Jesse. Jesse has a son, and his name is David. So it's Boaz and Ruth. They have Obed. Obed means worship. He's a worshiper. By the way, that's going to run in the family. They have a son. His name is Jesse. Jesse has a son. Jesse's son's name is David. And so it may very well be. And by the way, our Hebrew Bible and our English Bible, of course, does not indicate this. But if you go back to the 3rd century Septuagint, it's the Greek translation of the Aramaic of the Old Testament and the Hebrew of the Old Testament is translated into Greek during the 3rd century. They call it the Septuagint. The Septuagint attributes Psalm 91 to David. And so I'm going to go out on a limb here and just say, most likely, David wrote it. And if David did write it, we are actually reading right now the words of David's great-grandfather, who is speaking these very words that David is going to write during his lifetime, and quite possibly, Boaz said it to Obed, Obed said it to Jesse, Jesse hands it down to David, and the Holy Spirit of God uses David to make it the inspired word of God. And what a beautiful analogy. Today, ladies and gentlemen, if you are a believer and you are walking with God and you are abiding in Him, you are under His wings of protection, you are under His wings of provision, and there ain't no better place to be. I remember as a little boy, when I went to children's church, there was always a story that stood out to me that was told when I was just 8 years old. It was about a farmer whose farm had burnt to the ground. A fire had started, the wind had carried the flames, fanned the flames, and it basically just pulverized and incinerated his entire farm. After it was over, the farmer goes back to his farm and he's walking around. He's got his overalls on. You can kind of picture him. He's walking around with his hands in his pockets. And he's just frustrated, and he looks around, and tears are running down his cheeks. And he sees an old heap over there of something that's charred. And he goes over there, and he just takes his foot, and he just kicks it as hard as he can out of frustration. And then he realizes that he has just kicked the charred remains of a hen. And he looks over and the feathers are just kind of going everywhere. And then he just kind of feels bad. And then he hears something. He turns around and little chicks start running out from under where she was. That mother hen had covered those little chicks with her wings. And when the fire came, she burnt to death, saving those little chicks that they might live. And I thought, what a precious story and what a precious illustration of what Jesus and what God does for me. Because he has covered me with the protective and provisional wings of his glory. And he gave his life for me that I could be protected and I could be provided for. And ladies and gentlemen, today it might be that you can't count on one person in your life to come through. Can I remind you of this? According to Psalm 91 and according to Boaz, you can abide under the wings of the Almighty God, and no matter what comes your way, he will cover you. He will cover you. And so here's Boaz in his pity. Well, he's demonstrating to Ruth, I care about you. In his prayer, he is praying that God's wings would cover her. By the way, do you remember this when we talk about Jesus? Matthew chapter 23, 37. Do you remember Jesus? This is during the final days of his life. And he says this as he looks over Jerusalem. And as they have rejected the prophets and as they have ultimately rejected him, the prophet, this is what he says prior to his crucifixion. He says, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the one who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her, how often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. I don't want to be Jerusalem today in that sense. Man, today, allow God to cover you. Allow him to, hey, if you're not saved, allow him to cover you with the blood that he shed, the atoning blood that will cover every sin that you've ever committed and save your soul from eternal hell. If you rejoice in that today, if that's happened to you today, say amen. It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing. So, we see the psalmist speaking it in Psalm 91, Jesus speaking it in Matthew 23, Boaz is speaking it in Ruth chapter 2. Be under his wings. What a great prayer. How about his partiality toward Ruth? Look at verse 14. Now Boaz said to her at mealtime, come here, eat of the bread, dip your piece of bread in the vinegar. So she sat beside the reapers, and he passed parched grain to her, and she ate and was satisfied and kept some back. Verse 15, when she rose up to glean, Boaz commanded his younger men, saying, let her glean even among the sheaves. In other words, not just in the corners. And do not reproach her. Also let grain from the bundles fall purposely. It's where we get handfuls on purpose. You ever heard of that? Handfuls on purpose. If you're reading Old King James, it's going to say something to that degree. It's a let the grain from the bundles fall purposely for her. Leave it that she may glean, and do not rebuke her. Boaz has already given Ruth free access to the executive water cooler. He's smitten with her. He has protected her from the men. You remember, he's told them, don't you touch this girl. Leave her alone. Do not touch her. But now he does something even greater. He invites her to eat at his table with the reapers. And then he tells his reapers, he says, I want you to purposely. Number one, you remember before they're going into the corners. Leave the corners for the reapers, the gleaners. Leave the corners for the gleaners. And here is Ruth, and she's moved from being a gleaner, and now she's become somewhat of a reaper. Because he says, leave handfuls from the bundles in her path to ease her workload, to increase her gathering. And all of this, Boaz is sending a message, and here's what it is. Ruth, I have chosen you. How many of y'all believe Boaz is slightly interested in Ruth? Anybody with me? Absolutely. Absolutely. I have chosen you. I have chosen you. Verse 14 says, he says, come here. Verse 15 says, do not reproach her. In other words, make the path clear. Verse 16 says this, do not rebuke her. In similar fashion, here's what Jesus has done. Jesus has said to you, come on. And he has said to your sin, do not reproach her. He said to Satan, do not rebuke her. Do not rebuke them. Let them come. Jesus is preparing the way. He's clearing the way that we, as the reaper, can come. Which brings us to the reaper. So who's the reaper? Ruth's the reaper. Number one, Boaz. His pity, his partiality. Ladies and gentlemen, as we look through all of this, we see so many things that he is showing toward her, his prayer. Beautiful thing. But then we get to the reaper. Boaz, the redeemer. Ruth, the reaper. In these verses, three things stand out to me as well as a reaper. Number one, her tenderness. Look at verse 13. Our Bible says in verse 13, go back just a couple of verses. Remember, I'm going out of order. Ruth said to Boaz, let me find favor in your sight, my lord, for you have comforted me and have spoken kindly to your maidservant, though I am not one of your maidservants. Here's what's happened. Ruth, and all that she's been through, she has been tenderized by God through the trouble and through the heartache of her short life. And I just want to tell you this now, because you've got to get into the heart of Ruth. Remember what I've asked you to do. Whenever you read a narrative in the Bible, don't ever make yourself God or Jesus, because you can't possibly relate and identify to that. However, make yourself somebody in the story. So in this, realize Ruth is a widow. Ruth has returned to Bethlehem with no prospects of ever being married or ever being a mother. Because in that culture, Jews just didn't marry Gentiles. And so Ruth, really, realistically, what Ruth was doing when she said, I'm going with you, Naomi, is she was more or less saying, I'm declaring myself in order to follow God. I'm never going to get married and I'm never going to have children. But I would rather have God than have that. And so in all of her heartache, she has buried Mahlon, her husband. She has left her home. She'll never see her family again, most likely. She's going into a place that probably will not accept her. And she has no prospects whatsoever in her mind of any man wanting anything to do with her, because she's a Moabitess in a Jewish culture. But in it all, here's what's happened. God has tenderized her heart. Now her dreams have been crushed. And they are unfulfilled. They have been trampled. And when that happens, ladies and gentlemen, one of two things is going to happen to you. You're either going to do one of two things. You're going to soften your heart toward God, or you're going to harden your heart toward God. And by the way, can we just be realistic? When those times come, everybody wants to preach to you, and everybody wants to tell you how you're supposed to feel and what you're supposed to do. And I just want to be realistic today and just tell you, when people are hurting, the last thing you need to do is go to them and preach to them a message about how they're supposed to feel and what they're supposed to do. All you do in that situation is you comfort them in the power of the Holy Spirit, loving that person and realizing there's some things to work through. If you've ever been hurt deeply, then you know this. You know the first thing you're going to do as a believer is you're going to look to heaven and you're going to say, why in the world did this happen to me? And that's just human nature. And you're going to question God. And by the way, forgive me for saying it, you might even get mad at him. You say, well, that's so unchristian to get mad at God. Well, forgive me, I've been mad at him. I've been bitter. I've wanted to turn and walk away. Those are tough times. And Ruth is in one of those tough times. She's buried her husband. She's buried her father-in-law. She's buried her brother-in-law. She's left her family. She's in a brand new place. It would be very, very hard for her, or very, very easy for her to get hard toward God. But what you see here is you see a tenderness. She's working through it. She's trusting God with all of her heart, which takes us to her tenacity. Look at verse 17. We see that she's been tenderized by God. She's allowed God to tenderize her heart. Look at verse 17. So she gleaned in the field until evening and beat out what she had gleaned, and it was about an ephah of barley. An ephah is about 50 pounds. It's a little more than a bushel. Now that's significant, and you'll see why in a minute. Verse 21, our Bible says, Ruth the Moabite said, he also said to me, you shall stay close. Now, this is her conversation later with Naomi when she goes back home. She said to Naomi, she said, Boaz said to me, you shall stay close by my young men until they have finished all my harvest. In verse 23, our Bible says, So she stayed close by the young women of Boaz to glean until the end of the barley harvest and wheat harvest, and she dwelt with her mother-in-law. You know, here's the thing about Ruth. She didn't just work all day. She worked all harvest season. Barley harvest, wheat harvest, she worked the whole thing. And something that stands out to me in verse 17 is that she is apparently carrying an ephah of barley back home. Now, I don't know about you ladies. You know, as I look around the room here, I'm sure there's some women that can do this. And if you can, you know, I don't want to tussle with you, for sure. But Ruth is tough. I mean, if you pick up 50 pounds and carry it back to your home, I mean, she's a finisher. She didn't quit. What a great trait for an Old Testament woman. But hey, what a great trait for a New Testament believer. I mean, to carry a load that heavy and to carry it all the way back and not to quit and to keep on. And so I just say this to you today. She's tender, but she's tenacious. I mean, she ain't quitting. And I know during COVID season, I know that there's been some tough times. And I know there's some tough times coming. I do know as I watch television that Christianity is against the tide of this culture that we live in. And I do realize that we're going to be part of the cancel culture. If you are a Christian, at some point, they're going to try to cancel you. That's going to happen because of your position on certain issues, even politically. When you take a position on same-sex marriage and you take a position on abortion, when you take that position, you are declaring yourself to be a follower of God. Now, I know there are people who are not followers of God who take the same position. But as believers, those are the positions we have to take because those are the positions that God takes. And once you take that position, you are in reality declaring yourself to be working against this dark culture that's out here. And in doing so, you're going to come under attack. The Apostle Paul, in his swan song in 2 Timothy, this is what he said. He said, I fought a good fight, I finished my course, I've kept the faith. He was tenacious. He had tenacity. He was a finisher. And so today, I just declare to you this. Right now, would you declare yourself before God to be a finisher for Him? Just say, no matter what happens, God, in your strength, I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. I'm going to be a finisher because times are getting tougher. The days are getting darker. The culture is becoming more and more corrupt. And Christianity is going to be the enemy, ladies and gentlemen, of the United States of America at some point. Isn't that sad? The very country that we live in was founded upon the very faith that we practice, and the country now is turning on its faith. And so if you still believe in Judeo-Christian values, and if you still subscribe to the morality of Scripture, the day is coming when it's sad to say it, but the very country that these men and women fought and died for, that we commemorate and celebrate this weekend, that very country is turning on its roots, rewriting or trying to rewrite its constitution and trying to relegate every person that believes otherwise to the sidelines. And so when I speak of tenacity today, I'm not speaking of the same tenacity that we were thinking about 20 years ago or even 10 years ago. It's a brand new thing because exponentially things are getting worse. You say, Pastor John, you're just a preacher of doom and gloom. I read the paper. Actually, that's a lie. I don't read the paper, but I do watch the news. I do watch the news. I am keeping up with what's going on. I am watching this thing get crazier and crazier and crazier. And more corrupt. And the day is coming when Peace Saving Baptist Church and churches just like it are going to be under attack. And here's my question to you. Are you a finisher? Are you going to be a finisher? When times get tough, are you going to get tougher? When your life is threatened, have you even thought about what you're going to do at that point? You say, Pastor John, what are you talking about? My life being threatened. Go to Nazi Germany. See how quickly it happened there when the ball started rolling. History has a tendency to repeat itself. You say, are you saying that the United States of America could become just like Nazi Germany? That's exactly what I'm saying. When corrupt people get into power, they'll do anything to keep the power, and they'll do away with anybody who gets in the way of their power. And we're not there yet. But Adolf Hitler had a cancel culture. You did not subscribe to what he was putting down, you were dead. Read the history of Dietrich Bonhoeffer. See how he was treated. Executed in 1945 for his position against the Nazis. What a great Christian pastoral leader dies for his faith. And you might be called on to do the same. Now, I pray it don't happen. That's not what I want for my kids. It's not what I want for me. However, it's not up to me, is it? And it's not up to you. Here's the choice we do get to make. Are we going to be tenacious enough to stand when the threat comes? Because it is coming. Notice also Ruth's trustworthiness. Verse 18, our Bible says this. Then she took it up and went into the city, and her mother-in-law saw that what she had gleaned. So she brought out, and watch this, gave to her what she had kept back after she had been satisfied. I do like this. Ruth, apparently, as you read the passage, Ruth is sitting at the table with Boaz, and she's eating of the best of the food. But then in her heart, here's the thing, and this is what makes her trustworthy. She had saved food back for Naomi. She could have eaten and eaten and eaten and just forgot all about Naomi, but the Bible says she brought that food to Naomi along with the grain that she had gleaned, an ephah, you know. And I think how generous, how thoughtful, you know, that she's not keeping it all for herself. I have discovered something in my short life. It's not so short anymore, but compared to Ronnie Collins, it's very short. Amen? I have discovered something in my 51 years, just from an observation. Generally speaking, generous people are trustworthy people. Have you noticed that? Generous people are trustworthy people. They can be trusted because they characteristically look out for others in addition to themselves, and many times even above themselves and to the exclusion of themselves. Now, where do we find that ultimate example? We've already mentioned him today. We'll mention him several times. We'll mention him several times again. Jesus is the ultimate example in this category. He's the most generous, and ladies and gentlemen, he's the most trustworthy. Can I get an amen? Faithful is he that calls you, who also will do it. And he calls on believers to do the same, to bless others. Here's what Naomi's doing. Here's what Ruth is doing. Ruth is blessing Naomi as Boaz has blessed her. Today, application, has God blessed you today? Has he blessed you? Here's my question. Are you blessing others? You know, during COVID season, it's easy to get selfish. It's easy to get self-centered. You don't believe that? Go to the toilet paper aisle during COVID season. How many of y'all believe people were looking out for each other or people looking out for themselves? Anybody believe that? How about this one-day gas shortage we had? I had a guy in front of me at the gas station, had 350-gallon things there, you know, filling it up with gas, you know. And of course, you know, I gave him a pass because his business, he might be a mower or something like that, and his business is counting on that. But, you know, you just think, man, as soon as there's a crisis, what do? The first thing we do is say, we're going to go buy the whole roll. We're going to buy the whole row of toilet paper, and we're going to pump as much gas as we. Hey, there was one lady who was. They caught her pumping gas in a trash bag. What are you going to do with that? Talk about dangerous. Pumping gas in a trash bag, going to put it in her car. They had to go out there and take it away from her. People, we get crazy. And the truth is, you know, in COVID season, it may be that we've gotten a little bit selfish and we got self-centered, and maybe we're self-absorbed a little bit. And ladies and gentlemen, it's time to get back. I've been preaching this for a couple of weeks, and I'm going to keep preaching it because it's time. I'm working on a message right now. It's time to get back. It's time to get back to church. It's time to get back to serving God. We have been sidetracked. A little bit of our ministry has been hijacked through this whole thing. But ladies and gentlemen, come September, Pastor Jared, myself, Miss Rebecca, and others, we're trying to put together plans so that we can get back on track. And ladies and gentlemen, people are still dying and going to hell, and we got to be aware of that, and we've got to get out here and do something about it. And so as a church, we've done well. Attendance-wise, we've held pretty strong. We're getting kind of back to where we were. We're not there yet. Hey, let me tell you something, though. One of the biggest things that people were worried about, isn't this something? One of the biggest things that pastors were worried about is the giving. Do you know at our deacons meeting the other day, Perry, what percentage are we up from last year? We're up 18% in our giving from last year. Isn't that something? And that's because Donnie Smith came off of some of that money. We've been praying about that, and it finally happened. No, it's just because God's people through that. What a great commentary for our church, and I've talked to other pastors who've said the same. You know, that people during this time, that they have been trustworthy, they have continued to give towards God's work. Now it's time to do in action what we've done in our giving, and that is get busy. So, I close with this. Number one, our Redeemer. Boaz represents, in the physical sense, what Jesus is in the spiritual sense. Number two, the reaper. There's Ruth. She represents, in the physical sense, what we are in the spiritual sense today. Trustworthy, tenacious, ladies and gentlemen, As we look through her life, there's so many things that we could talk about today, but I want to close with this. I want to close with Naomi. She's the rejoicer. Remember, she left. She left full. She comes back empty. Is there anything that could bring her joy back? Look at verse 19. Our Bible says this. And her mother-in-law, Naomi, said to Ruth, "Where have you gleaned today? And where did you work? Blessed be the one who took notice of you." And Ruth told her mother-in-law, Naomi, she says, with whom she had worked, and said, "The man's name with whom I work today is," and you kind of picture Ruth going, "The man's name is Boaz." Kind of a little something to it, you know? She didn't just say Boaz. She said, "Boaz." It's kind of like every time my wife says my name, she always says, "John." And if she's in a real good mood, she'll call me Lord, but it doesn't happen often. No, I'm kidding. You kind of picture, you know, she's kind of, you know, you can see something. Naomi sees something in her eyes when she says Boaz. And so, look at verse 20. Then Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, "Blessed be he of the Lord, who has not forsaken his kindness to the living and the dead." In other words, God is looking out not just for us. He's looking out for, and we'll see this in a few weeks, the name of Elimelech. The name. You'll see that in a few weeks. I'll explain that later. Don't have time today. And Naomi said to her, "This man is a relation of ours." And watch this. She gets even more specific. "He is one of our close relatives." Man, here's something. This girl, she's got a new attitude. Before she was bitter. Before, remember, she came back and, hey, things are terrible. All of a sudden, she realizes, whoa, where did you go today? Where did you end up? Boaz. Wait a minute, Boaz is a relative of Elimelech. And not only that, this will come into play, he's a close relative. And so Naomi's wheels start turning because she's thinking ahead. And she's thinking, wait a minute, what is God doing here? I left full. I came back empty. There's no hope. And Ruth has ended up at the field of Boaz. And Boaz is doing what? And he's treating you how? And he sent what? Naomi, maybe Ruth hadn't figured it out totally yet, but Naomi has. This dude has taken a liking to you. So she's got a new attitude. Not only that, she's got a new anticipation. Look back at verse 20. She said, "He's a relative, he's a relation, he's a close relative." She anticipates, there's another, we talked about the principle of gleaning. There's another principle of redemption that we haven't discussed yet that we're going to discuss next week. But Naomi is already thinking, wait a minute, maybe God's going to do something here. Maybe God's going to do something. She's basically telling Ruth, "And whatever you do, don't you blow it. Don't you blow it." She gives her some new advice, new attitude, new anticipation. Watch this. Wait a minute. What was Naomi's advice before? What was Naomi's advice before? Go back. Go to your relatives. Go to your religion. Go back. See, when you're in a bad place in life, a lot of times you'll just give bad advice. But look at this good advice in verse 22. Naomi said to Ruth, her daughter-in-law, "It is good, my daughter, that you go out with his young women and that people do not meet you in any other field." You hear what Naomi's saying? He told you to stay in his field. You, girl, you stay in his field. You don't go to any other field. You stay where he can see you, and you stay visible, and let's just see what happens in this situation. What a great counselor that Naomi is now. She got a brand new attitude. Wait a minute. Whose field were you in? She got a new anticipation. Wait, God might be working something here. She got some new advice. You stay where you're supposed to be. Today, here's my question. Do you speak the language? It is so sad so sad to watch people in church pews or people in church seats die and go to hell. And they're going by the droves. It never occurred to them that the language that they speak is not the same language as others. If you're here today, say, Pastor John, I don't even know what you're talking about. Well, that's okay. You don't speak the language. It's not because I'm smarter than you. It's because the Holy Spirit has opened my eyes and opened my heart and opened my mind, as he has to many others. But you may be sitting here and you say, you know, Pastor John, I'll just be honest with you. I don't even like church. I don't care a thing about God. The gospel doesn't mean anything to me. Well, that's because you don't speak the language. Stand to your feet if you would, please. I'm going to ask you a question I asked you again a few weeks ago. All right? Here's the question. 1 million years from now, 1 million years from now, where will you be and why will you be there? Are you there? Everybody with me? 1 million years from now, where will you be and why will you be there? If you understand those two questions, raise your hand and just hold it up. Keep it up. Keep your hand up. Is everybody's hand up? Where will you be and why will you be there? All right, now, after you've answered those questions, have you answered them? Where will you be? Not everybody. Why will you be there? If you've answered those questions, sit down. All right, so today, I have put before you the question to be answered. Now, 1 million years from now, you will remember this. Are you with me? 1 million years from now, you will remember these two questions, regardless of where you are. And if you answered, I'll be in hell, and here's why, you will wish to God you could come back and say, Pastor John, can you ask me that question again? I'd like to respond differently today. For the rest of us, how about this? Number one, anybody glad to be redeemed and bought back from the slavery of sin? Amen. And with that, Pastor Jared, if you'll come, let's all stand together. If you don't know Jesus today as your Savior, I want to tell you, Jesus loves you. He died for you. He wants to save you today. If you'll trust Him as your Savior, put your faith and trust in Him and say, Lord, I want to speak the language. Lord, I want to speak the language. Lord, immerse me in the culture. Lord, save me. He'll save you today. Now, some of you may be here today and you say, Pastor John, I'm just not ready for that. That's okay. I just want you to at least be thinking about it. Start thinking about it. Start praying about it. And when that time comes, come to me. Come to somebody that can counsel you. Remember, we're not the solution. He is. But we want to take the Word of God, and we want to show you how you can know that you know that you know that 1 million years from now, you're with Jesus. You're with Jesus. So let's do this. Pastor Jared, if you will, if you'll lead us, let's stand together. Our altar's open as always. This morning you say, Pastor John, I want to get saved right now. I'm not waiting. I'm getting saved right now. I'm right here. Just come and say, I'm ready to give it over. I want to speak the language. I want to be immersed in the culture. I want to enjoy the golf game. Come to me. I'll take you to Him. Let's sing together.
I love you, Lord.
What a great song.
Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands.
Lift it up, church.
From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God.
If you have an announcement, if you will, if you'll make your way to the center while they're doing that. Hey, do something with me, okay? Do this one. They go, y'all ready? On the count of three. One, two, three. Y'all aren't very good at it. Come on. One, two, three. Take a real deep breath. You know what that is? That's a gift of God. And you know something else about that? You're not guaranteed another one. A lady just came down and shared her testimony with me and talked about how that she sat gripping a pew for an hour and a half at a service. And finally, she just said, I'm not going to hell for anybody, and she got saved. And thank you so much, Melissa. By the way, I said she wasn't. Yes. Let me make sure I'm clear. She didn't get saved this morning. She got saved years ago, but she was sharing with me that she had gotten saved, okay? But Melissa, I didn't think you were here a while ago, and so thank you for sharing. What year was it when you got saved? Was that 18 or 19? Oh, 1988, right? Okay, and we're still praying for David to get saved, so y'all pray for David back there. And no, I'm kidding, but thank you so much for sharing that. Now tell me again, it was 19 what? Okay, the year I graduated high school. All right, so good, fantastic. All right, Rebecca, come on, please.
Melissa, she also wrote the poem that's in your newsletter today.
Oh, yeah.
A Memorial Day poem she wrote years ago, so thank you
Great
for
job.
Contributing
Great
to our
job.
Memorial
that was
Day.
Really good.
Yeah, it's really good. So read it if you get a chance. It's on the welcome desk. Okay, so we have a few announcements. Next Sunday, June 6th, let's start with the baby shower. We've got a baby shower drop-off for Liz Hoots. I'm having a boy, so she needs some stuff. Obviously, there's nothing but females in her home right now. So let's get, besides Jesse, of course, but he's getting on a boy. So let's help get some boy stuff to Miss Liz. And the drop-off is at the nursery drop-off table. Also, we have a wedding shower. And I believe that's the next slide up there for Jordan. Jordan, not yet. Jessica and Jacob. Too many J's in your family as well. Mine too. Yes, for Jessica and Jacob next Sunday in the gym. And the time slot is from 12:30 there. So hopefully you can get your shopping done and get that down there as well. Okay, we also have another. There's Jessie here this morning. I have a slide up for a blood drive that's happening. She wanted me to make sure we knew that she's hosting a blood drive at the Collide Church here in town on Thursday, July 1st. So make your mark your calendars for that, if you would, and help contribute to that awesome cause as well. And I just want to say, he's been talking about getting back, and I don't have a slide for this, but we are getting ready to open up kids ministry again, but I need some teams to put together so I can know how many Sundays I can even start allowing our kids to come on back. So if you love to teach, or if you just love to assist, especially if you have kids that you'd like to see come back, I'm talking to the live stream audience as well.
Or if you just have a pulse.
If you're able-bodied, I've said that before, nursery, we need more workers, children's church, and junior church, we'd love to have you on the team.
Amen. Let's get that thing rolling.
Oh, Pastor John.
Pastor Jared.
A couple of things. I know Pastor John mentioned something a while ago about our giving, and we just praise the Lord for what he's done. We don't harp on it. We really don't say a whole lot about giving. You guys have just been so faithful. I know we have some people, though, here who are new to our church, and I just want to make sure you know some of the ways that you can give. We do have an app, and it's called the Church Center app, and if you download that app, you can actually give right through that app. You can also go to peacehaven.com. There's a link right on our homepage on peacehaven.com where you can give as well. And then each Sunday, we have ushers at the door. So if you're on your way out and you want to drop something in the offering plate, it is back there. We have not been passing the plate, of course, because of COVID. We'll probably get back to that at some point, it is back there. So just to make sure you know those things. For those who have students in our launch student ministry, I do have a summer calendar that we put together. It just kind of lets you know what kind of activities we're doing over the summer. It is back on the Welcome Center desk. You can pick that up on your way out. And then we also have a church-wide reading plan that's been created for the summer months also. So if you're reading along with us in the church-wide reading plan, which I've loved, I hope that some of you have been following along as well. I love being able to read where my brothers and sisters are reading as well. That is on our Welcome Center desk too. So make sure you pick one of those up before you leave this morning.
All right. And by the way, let's give them a hand today. They were shorthanded today and did a great job leading worship. Jordan asked me last week, she said, Pastor John, do you know what Boaz was before he was married? I said, no. She said he was ruthless. And so today we've been chuckless, but we've done a good job. Thank y'all so much. Connor, great job today. Appreciate that, Jared. Thank you for stepping in. All right, those of you who have my class for next week, 9:30 Daniel class, is almost full. And so I can have 50 in there. And so I think I have a couple of slots open. So if you have not gotten in, I'm well up in the 40s. And so if you want to get in on that, please get with me quickly because it's going to close probably today. Tracy, thank you all so much for being here today. It's always an honor to have you. And Jules, and is that Leah? Is that Leah there? Yeah. And Titus back there, Titus with the hair. I like it. It looks good, man. That's good. Do you have a beard too? A little bit of beard action coming in? Oh, okay. All right. Put some Rogaine on your face. It'll come in later, all right? But it's always a pleasure to have them. Ted, come here. I want you to dismiss us in prayer, if you would, please. And as Ted comes, just a quick reminder of that. And no choir practice today, so I guess enjoy your Memorial Day weekend. God bless you, and we will see you soon. Ted, if you will, if you get one of the mics here. Can we grab a mic, somebody? And he'll dismiss us, and then you'll be sent.
Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for allowing us to be in your house today. We just ask you to continue to be with us. We ask you to bless those that served our country and continue to serve our country. And we just ask you to be with those that are sick and help those recover and help our church fill back up and be with us and guide us, lead us, direct us. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Visitors, go to the Welcome Center. We got a gift for you. Thank you for being here today. We appreciate so much you being here. God bless you. You're sent.